And here we are, folks.
Hey, good Friday afternoon. Here, let me go this way. There. Good Friday afternoon. How is everybody out there? We are fresh back from the Diverge Youth Retreat. As we speak, we can look out into the courtyard and dozens of kids are out there actually peering in the window and playing basketball. But it was a great, great time.
It was awesome. I cannot say enough. 100 youth on the top of a mountain, and God showed up. It was powerful. People gave their lives to Christ. People got filled with the Holy Spirit. The power of God fell down. We prayed and prayed and prayed over these youth. This is 1 week of getting under the power of the Word and under the Holy Spirit. And last night was the culmination of many times of prayer and just letting God move. It's the move of the Holy Spirit. And that's what I love about God. He moves by His Spirit and He changes hearts and lives. People were delivered of demonic oppressions. And I cannot say enough. It just made my heart so happy that this young generation is being changed by God's anointing. And His
you know,
word.
This generation, I know many of you out there, we've cried out for a move of God in this young generation.
Yeah.
And we are seeing it.
Yeah, we are.
We're seeing it. And I remember, of course, we're old, but back in the day when I first came to Christ, you know, we were coming out of the hippie generation, and, you know, they just thought, you know, the adults just thought that generation was just debased and lost, and, you know, could God reach any of those people? But He can, and
yes.
He does, and He's doing the exact same thing
yes,
today. We're
yes,
seeing it happen.
Yes,
the kids at the altar crying out to God, getting their lives changed, serving Him with all their hearts. And
it's amazing.
The other amazing part is that all the counselors
amazing.
Are the ones that have been raised up doing the exact same thing. I shared last night at the camp that, you know, all of our particular biological children, plus all their friends, it seems like yesterday they were the campers. You know, they were the campers. But now they're the ones running the camp. And they're giving that that fire to the next generation.
Saturday.
I had a couple of scriptures, if you don't mind if I read them.
Yeah, go ahead. Help yourself.
In the scripture in Psalm 145:4, it says, "One generation shall commend your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts."
Wow.
And that's just the power of the responsibility of the church is to raise up the next generation. We always feel like only the adults care about the things of God, but really the children, the young people will just bypass you, you know, in a flash.
Yes.
And one other scripture that's similar is Psalm 78:4. We will not hide them from their children. We will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, His power and the wonders that He has done.
Absolutely.
And so it's exciting.
What I think
you gave an awesome message last night on the baptism in the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, the Lord helped. But who here watching?
I have to put my glasses on. We've got Jennifer Cruz is there. We've got Dallas Martin. Hey, Kathy Simon watching from Florida. Love you.
Kathy.
Michael Baxter, Jackie Martin, Cammie Ward. Always fun to have Cammie Ward on there. We love you guys. So good to have you.
We're going to have Cammie Ward on here one day.
She's funny.
She is funny.
She is funny. But you know what? I have something, something I just realized this week. In 1977, that was the year I got saved. I won't tell you how many. Well, you're going to figure out how old I am anyway. So in 1977,
let's do the math.
On Saturday, July the 16th at 1:30 in the morning was when I gave my heart to Christ.
Wow.
This year, the calendar lines up completely. So that today is Friday, July the 15th. Tomorrow is Saturday, July the 16th. And at 1:30 this morning, it'll be 45 years since I gave my life to Christ.
That's awesome.
And I was just thinking about how, you know, I was a young lady back then. And here I am on my anniversary weekend at a youth retreat proclaiming the works of Christ to this next generation. And so I thought about how you came to Christ at a young age.
Yeah.
I came to Christ at a young age. This is the perfect time for kids to get on fire for God. You know, they have no inhibition. They believe they can do anything. And it's just so exciting to see. We're kind of, you can tell we're kind of on a high right now, just excited to be coming off of the youth retreat.
Well, you know, scripture talks about that the parents and the leaders of the church are responsible to raise up the next generation. And to do that, we got to be focused on youth and young people. Churches that don't focus on youth and young people are missing it. And really, I've just had to up my game as a church leader on putting more focus on young and allowing young to do what any job they want to in, like, even in the main sanctuary. Sometimes we'll say, well, now you got to be fully grown for your work in the main sanctuary. You got to be mature. I don't see that. Like little Blythe, what, she's seven?
She's eight, I think.
She's eight, is you know, receives the offering, complete with a little radio, and she's just a big smile. She's into it. And I said, yeah. And we got others that literally, like Haniel and his boys. It's like, use them as ushers. Use them as greeters. Use them as teachers. I won't give one of the girls' names because I protect the names. But there's a young girl that in 1 year ago, she was off towards ways of the world, very much away from God and angry, didn't really want to go to Diverge. But in that Diverge week, her heart was turned 180. Mm-hmm. Now she's a preacher. Now she's an evangelist. Now she's leading the other students in her own high school to Christ. And so I just felt led of the Lord, like I'm in the middle of giving the altar call. I said, I just use her as a testimony. She came and shared where she was just a year ago, sitting in the seats, rebellious, non-receptive, pushing away from the things of God. And then she just shared her testimony in a nutshell. I said, give the altar call. Well, you would have, I mean, she gave the altar call like no one else gave the altar call. She is imploring them to come. And she said, you don't have to live dead. You don't have to live away from God. You can get connected. Get this fire. Let this fire change you. You don't have to live a dried out, cold Christian life. Well, I feel like we need to promote young people. That's what church needs to do. Push them forward. Let them begin to preach. Let them begin to teach. Put them in responsibility positions so they've got to use their skills early. Really, that's how the church should function.
Mm-hmm.
We got to keep the youth engaged in the whole function of the church, not just, well, this is the youth group and they do functions in the youth. They has to be spread out across the church. Mm-hmm. And they've got to give people opportunities to share their faith and to give service to God at an early age. Because what happens is, when they finally go to the adult, quote, adult stage, then they're disengaged from what the function
from
of the church
the adult
are.
Church, yeah.
And they say, well, listen, I don't know anybody here. I'm out. I'm gone. So the church has been missing it. So we've got to really focus on the youth and upon the people of God.
Amen.
In raising up people of God in our youth.
Yes, amen. So anyway, we're excited. We're excited about the things of God. We really feel like we're in a season in the church. I know you hear that a lot of churches have closed. Some churches have cooled off. But really in our circles, people are on fire for God. People are winding up again and going out on the mission field, doing the work of God. And it's very exciting because, you know, I know this about young people. If church is boring, they don't want to come. Kids want a challenge. They want to be challenged to get out on the mission field. They want a challenge to get out there where it may not be safe. And so they're the ones who lead the way. And we just want to, just anyone who's watching right now, if you've got young people in your life, do not cease to pray for them. In fact, Wednesday night, there was a real move of God Wednesday night where one of our young people who had really become on fire for God and had gone off to the ramp in Alabama. And she was giving that testimony. We were talking about it. And Pastor Mirek had a call for parents who were standing in faith for a wayward child, wayward children. And that altar was full of parents coming forth and just crying out to God for their children. Some of them children, many of them their adult children that were not serving the Lord. But I just want to encourage you, God can always reach in and touch people and draw them out, especially when they have praying family, praying mom, praying dad. You're crying out to God for your children. Don't ever give up on them. Just really seek God, bring them in. God needs them. He needs them in the army. He needs them in the kingdom. And it was just touching to see the altars filled with people crying out to God for their children. And no one is ever a hopeless case. No one is without hope. I was a hopeless case. You were probably pretty hopeless.
Yeah, I was.
Were you hopeless?
Oh, yes. I was a rebellious little boy.
I know. You've changed a lot. So I know. I was
made
pretty
some
hopeless.
Progress.
I was pretty hopeless. I don't know who was praying for me. I always say I was the firstborn from the dead. I just kind of came to Christ by accident. I just called out to God in a desperate time of my life. And a lot of times people need to come to that point where they're desperate and they don't feel like there's any other hope for them around. They look up. And when you pray for those people in that moment when they need God, they will reach up. And as soon as they do, God is right there for them and can make that change.
Yes.
No one's around them. No one sees it happening. But God reaches in and gets a hold of their life. So don't give up on your loved ones.
You know, we were just sharing at the prayer meeting at the noon hour. We shared on John 16, 23 and 24, where Jesus says in the King James, hitherto, or in the New King, until now, meaning that the demarcation was, before I shared this, this was not available. But today, he said, I'm establishing a new covenant. And when he went to the cross and rose again from the dead, you can now go to the God, and these are the verses, this is what he said. Whatever, that's like a blank check. Whatever. So what is it you need? Whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give it you.
Wow. There's
no equivocation there. It's just that's what, and he says, then he goes, ask that you may receive, that your joy may be full. And so I want to be sharing on this next week's coming up. The issue is believing it when you pray and not wavering when you pray. The issue is the time that you pray to the time that you receive, that is where the enemy can make you lose it.
That's where the rubber meets the road,
because
doesn't it?
Because if you will not back off your faith, that answer is coming to you. It is unstoppable.
True.
It's unstoppable. It's what he said. Otherwise, God's a liar. Is God a liar? It can't be. But until then, they couldn't pray in Jesus' name. They couldn't ask the Father in Jesus' name. But in the name of Jesus, through the power of that name, through the authority of that name, we go to the Father. Whatever. That's amazing. He says, now you could ask for lost souls. You could ask for your physical healing. Now the rest is have to be by my will. I'll determine what I will give you or not. But this whatever is like a blank check. The King James says whatsoever. Mm-hmm. Or whatever. And whatever, you know, kids use it in the vernacular. Whatever is like a, in fact, I don't like that word when it's used that way. It's like, I don't really care. Whatever, you know, it's whatever. But no, this word whatever is whatever. It's what you can think of. It's what you desire. Mark 11 talks about the what you desire. What things you desire. Believe that you receive, you shall have. Believe you see. No equivocation. And we got to stay in the Word, because your natural mind goes, I don't have the answer. If it's God's will, maybe it's not God's will. No, if it's something good, God wants to bless you.
Yes.
You can put your faith towards it, and it shall happen. And so we've got to get to this place where we are praying for our young people, and they're without a doubt, they're going to come to the fullness of the Holy Spirit, and they're going to be used of God to serve this end time generation. It says that David fulfilled, served, after David had served his generation,
served
he went on home.
Served the purpose of God.
He fulfilled the purpose of God. He fulfilled the call of God for his life, for that people that he was given. And I tell you, that's how we got to see our young people. There's a purpose for every life that's on the planet, and God wants to use it to bring people to himself. And when you get that in your spirit deep, and that's why young people, God, we got to raise them up and loose them. And I want to thank God for all the funding that came in from successful businessmen who wrote the checks to enable us to put so many on a scholarship. Otherwise, it wouldn't be there.
Yeah.
So it was the goodness of God coming down that blessed these young people. And may the blessing come back on the people that have sowed so generously. We thank you.
In fact, you were just telling me a story about one of our young people who've been coming here to the church for a while from one of our street read sites, was supposed to go to the camp, and I'll brag on my daughter. She went over there. He decided he wasn't going to go. She had to get him out of bed, get him some clothes.
No, he didn't have clothes. He went shopping, got him new clothes because he didn't want to wear what he had. It was too old. So got the clothes. Now he's got the clothes, got him out of bed, and drove him to the site to be picked up by the bus.
Yeah, so he went, and his life was radically changed.
Whoa!
Telling you, it pays. It pays to really sow seed in our young people. And
it does.
It's very gratifying.
All I know is, I was just came from Brother Rodney Howard Brown's camp for missionaries. So these are people that have graduated 2 years or the third year, which is an internship, 20, about split even, 50-50, 10 girls, 10 boys. And they're there for 3 weeks, living in a tent by a river, no electricity, no phones. They're just out there, showers outside, just, this is you with the skeeters. And
this is in hot Florida,
yeah.
Right?
But
hot
we had a big circle campfire, and Pastor Roddy and I, we sat and talked to them about missions and about reaching our world and about, this was the third final week, but and about how to relate to one another. They were given tons of work. Start at 5:30, end about 10 o'clock, do 1 hour PT every day, have to cut their own wood. I mean, everything is just like it is if you
Sounds
were
great.
Just out there as a missionary. So it
That's
was
for the young,
but it was all for the young. They're all in their early 20s, most of them, and they were just had a heart for God. But I thought about it. We need to do our own kind of mission camp. I'd like to do that. Start off with a week, then work to two, and I believe it could really be a benefit.
Yeah, I would love that. You would love that.
I would love it. We need more land.
Yeah.
I could rent places to go to get that done. We can go and get that done.
Amen. So anyway, well, let's talk about a couple things that are coming up. We have a great men's conference that is coming up.
Oh, yes.
And so we have got Daryl Strawberry. In fact, you talk about it because you're the man. You tell yes. about it.
Well, Daryl Strawberry, one of the most profound baseball players of his era. I realize it's like a few decades back, and so people go, Daryl who? Daryl Strawberry.
Us older people, we remember.
He was just a well-known name. Everyone
you
knew
You younger
his name.
People can Google him. Google him. Don't Google his before Christ, though. Don't.
Three-time national baseball champ. He was a rookie of the year. They said his swing was the sweetest swing of any baseball player ever. And that, unfortunately, he hit into drugs and into some things that really messed him up and caused his career to go south. And he would start again, get straight, then go south. It was kind of repetition of this cycle to finally get a true encounter with Jesus Christ. And now he goes around the country giving his testimony that Jesus Christ can set you free. He said, I had all the money in the world, women in the world, drugs in the world, fame in the world, none of that mattered. He said, you're still empty without Jesus. So we're inviting you, if you have some men that are maybe on the outskirts of their influence, you can maybe pull them in. Say, come, we got a Friday night. We're having like a
dinner,
a
barbecue. Dinner,
Dreamland barbecue. We have breakfast that Saturday morning. That's both of them. Daryl will be there. And then Sunday morning, 9:00, 11:15, he'll be ministering there. A great man, great testimony of, really, it's a restoration of hope. It's a message of hope because it brings restoration. When you hear his testimony, you don't realize how low down you can get. But God will pick you up no matter how down you go. He'll pick you up and make you victorious. Though I make my bed in hell, the Bible says, you are still with me. And so he'll raise you up and cause you to be delivered and set free. So bring men. Invite your call men to come to Daryl Strawberry. Go online. Sign them up. I think it's about $49. Covers the food and everything, registration. And it's going to be an awesome time.
Amen. Because, you know, we talk about the, you know, reaching the young people and how much, how valuable they are in the kingdom of God. But really, it cannot be overstated how much we need strong, godly men in the kingdom of God. In these days, media and whatever else is out there is always trying to bring the man down and take away masculinity. And that's not the way Jesus Christ meant it to be. He was a manly man, Jesus Christ was, and he raises up manly men. We need men in the kingdom of God. And so we encourage you, get your men out there, get your young, get your teens out there as well.
Yeah, get them out there.
And it's a great time to just connect with other men and to make relationships in the church, and that's super important. So
yes, hallelujah. Yeah. And then I have my dear friend, Pastor Randy Hooper will be here with us. He'll be here Sunday night. He's coming. And he comes from a very successful family. He said, my father was very, very successful. He has his own, I think they were in coal mining and oil. He had their own corporate jet. He kind of grew up with a giant silver spoon in his mouth. But then he went on to have his own businesses, were very successful in business. And God touched him and put him in with Brother Rodney. And for nearly 10 years, he ran the whole ministry, took over. And it's still today, he's the kind of like admin person on retainer. Very smart in business, very smart on contract reading and on negotiating and on just being running churches. And he goes around the country helping churches, not just the country, around the world, helping churches stand up on their feet, get organized, cinch in the slack, and become more efficient and effective. That's his DNA. But he also is a revivalist, and he holds revivals even in nations like, I think it was Nicaragua, where they have a big stadiums, these packed people in there, and given the word of faith and given the power of God. And so this Sunday night, he'll be ministering, and expect a revival message. A message will pick you up, build you in your faith, strengthen you in your walk with God. And so come and get touch with his presence. Let God fill you up with his glory. We believe for the great move of heaven to be upon his life and upon the service. Amen.
Amen. It's a summer to press in.
Amen. And then what else we got?
Last but not least, we're letting the women out. We've got a great class coming up on the Sundays in August called The Authentic Women. There's preaching on prayer. as Good. Pastor also is preaching on prayer in the Wednesday night services. And so we believe in prayer around here, and we just want to build up our prayer life. So much is accomplished in the prayer closet. Yeah. So much is accomplished in corporate prayer. We just can't thank God enough for just his amazing loving kindness and his mercy, who helps us with
Praise
absolutely
you,
everything.
Praise you, Jesus.
And so, but anyway, Praise we're moving on with summer, and we just want to encourage you, press into the things of God, stay on fire, avail yourself to whatever the church or is offering, and just get involved. And we just love you, and we encourage you, and we pray for you guys.
Let's pray.
I pray.
Father, I just agree in Jesus' name for everyone's life that they capture a fresh vision of Jesus, a fresh passion for his presence. And Lord, you touch them wherever they are. That Lord, no matter where they find themselves, Jesus, you always pick us up when we look to you and we call on your name. Father, we thank you for this wonderful promise that whatever we ask you in Jesus' name, you'll give it to us. And you told us to ask that we might receive, that our joy may be full. I pray, God, people watching would ask for the needs they have, whether it's a job, healing to their body, a relationship matter that needs to be straightened out and healed. Lord, whatever the need, we pray, God, that reach up to heaven and ask you in the mighty name of Jesus and stand believing for that answer, because Jesus, you are intercessor. You're the one that you're the go-between between us and the Father. And Father, you want to bless us. Every good and perfect gift comes from you. You want to pour it upon us. And so we want to be people of faith that don't waver when tough things happen. But we reach out by faith for all those watching, listening now. Let their faith be stirred up to receive the promises of God. Receive the blessing of God. Receive the favor of God. In Jesus' mighty name, we declare it of each one watching today and listening. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you.
God bless you.